بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله وحده، والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعد. أما بعد، قال الله عز وجل في كتاب آخر بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من ولده ووالده والناس أجمعين، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي: يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. In the last week's discussion regarding the seerah and the biography of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we went over the wives and the children of Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married 11 wives in his lifetime, and we went through the chronological order of the wives, which were Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, Sauda radiallahu ta'ala anha, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha, Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, Juwayriya radiallahu ta'ala anha, Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, Maymuna radiallahu ta'ala anha, and Safiya radiallahu ta'ala anha. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed in the marriage with Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha for 25 years. So he married her at the age of 25 and stayed in the marriage, or the marriage was for 25 years, and then Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha left this world. During the time of the marriage with Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not take another wife. The other wives that came after the death of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. This was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's first marriage, and it was Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha's third marriage. And we mentioned that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married 11 wives, not because of lust, not because of love, but because of various reasons, such as the statuses of the wives, the virtues of the wives, the previous marital experiences of the wives and of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the age gaps between Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the wives. Then we discussed the children of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All but one child was from Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, and one son was from the slave girl known as Maria Qibtiyya, and the son's name was Ibrahim radiallahu ta'ala anha. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had 7 children, 4 daughters: Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, Kulthum radiallahu ta'ala anha, Ruqayyah radiallahu ta'ala anha, and Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. Two sons, Abdullah, or 3 sons, Qasim, Abdullah, and Ibrahim radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Abdullah and Qasim radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Abdullah and Ibrahim radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, they both left this world in their infancy, and Qasim radiallahu an, he passed away at the age of approximately 6 or 7 years old. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we concluded on the point that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he buried six out of 7 children. He buried his wives also, and this obstacle, this trial of burying one's child, one's family members, it was there for, but given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that his heart could become softer, number one. Number two, over time, whatever was happening in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it would make it easier for him to live through the sacrifices and the trials that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it made him understand loss and hardship even more. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the person with the most softest of hearts. Because of the sacrifices that he went through, wherein he had to bury his wives, he had to bury his children, he had to lose his mother and father at a young age, his grandfather at a young age. These were these sacrifices or these trials came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for him to have great loss and understand this hardship and become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In today's discussion, we will start the reconstruction of the Kaaba.
Was reconstructed 5 times.
The Kaaba that we see before today. The Kaaba that we see today in Makkatul Mukarrama, there were 4 times before this that there was a Kaaba and it was demolished and it came back. It was constructed firstly by Adam alayhi salatu wasalam when Adam alayhi salatu wasalam came onto this earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Adam alayhi salatu wasalam that build my first house. So Adam alayhi salatu wasalam in the point of Ka'batullah, in the point where the Kaaba today is, he placed the foundation of the Kaaba and erected a small building. And this was the first house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of the earth. And this was the first Kaaba. Thereafter, we all know of the incident or the story of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam when his people disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a great flood of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam and the entire existence of mankind. So the people of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam who understood and believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those animals that had been rescued and saved in the ark, they had survived. But every single thing in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it so that the flood came and completely finished everything, wiped out everything, including the Kaaba. So much so that not even the foundation of the Kaaba was left. So after Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam's time, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam came onto this earth. And we all know the famous story. Then Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam with Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam, his son, his beloved son, they were commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reconstruct the Kaaba again, once again. And we are told that the bricks came down from Jannah and Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was placing the bricks or the concrete bricks in his position to make the Kaaba, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But because there was no trace of the foundation, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam was sent down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam that this is where you will build the Kaaba. The outline of the Kaaba was shown to Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam by Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam so that the original foundation could be used. So that the exact position where Adam alayhi salatu wasalam made the first Kaaba, that also stayed till today. This was the second reconstruction of the Kaaba. The third reconstruction of the Kaaba was just before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam received prophethood. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was of the age of around 35 years old, the Quraysh, they saw the state that the Kaaba was in. And they decided and they had this tamanna, they had this desire that we want to make it look more beautiful and we want to reconstruct the Kaaba. So the original structure that Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam had erected, it was roofless. There was no roof on the top of the Kaaba at that time. And because over time, because of the generations, the years that had passed, there was no one that was taking care of the bricks. It rains, the weather changes, the bricks erode and they crumble. So this also started to happen that some of the sides of the Kaaba had lowered so much so that it was coming to the lowest part of the ground. And because there was no roof, it was becoming unstable for it to stand on its own. Sometimes in the rain and also in the heavy rain, water and rain would gather inside the structure of the Kaaba. So the people of Quraysh, they came together and decided collectively that let us demolish the Kaaba entirely and let us rebuild the Kaaba again. Let us erect another Kaaba. So that we can have a building, we can have a Kaaba, we can have a place where we can follow and we can act upon the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Quraysh came together, they decided to demolish the Kaaba and start from the beginning. At that point, Abu Wahab bin Amr Makhzumi, who was Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's father's, Abdullah radiallahu anhu, his mother's brother.
So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's father, Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala an, his mother's brother, he addressed the people of Quraysh at that time. And he said to them that whatever is spent in the reconstruction of the Kaaba, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, should be done with only those, with that income, with that money which is of halal sources. How can it be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be a pure being and we build his house out of impure and unpure and haram sources of an income? So every cent, every penny that is spent in the building and the reconstruction of the Kaaba should be done with halal income and halal sources. And this was, they understood that the Kaaba, even before Islam, this Kaaba, this house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is significant and it is great and it has a high status in the eyes of people and in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People from all over the world would come. People would all from all over the Arabian Peninsula would come and they would perform pilgrimage around it. It was the sunnah of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam to come in the time of Hajj and perform pilgrimage even before Islam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam in a hadith he would mention that even before Islam came about, the advent of Islam came, we would go out in the time of Hajj and we would perform Umrah, we would perform tawaf around the Kaaba, we would do the acts of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, we would slaughter an animal, we would do the acts of Hajj because this was the sunnah of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. They would not understand, or they did not understand completely, that this was a sunnah of not only Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, but it will become a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam and a commandment of Islam. But they did this because of this, the sunnah of their forefather Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. So Abu Wahab, being a non-Muslim at that time, but being part of the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam and the people of Quraysh, he gave this advice and this stern advice to the people of Quraysh that whatever you are going to build now, whatever you are going to use now, it should always be from halal sources. A side note here, that even though we are Muslim, we understand the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is unfortunate that sometimes we purchase and we use haram income. We involve ourselves in interest. We involve ourselves in haram activities, which makes our income haram. There is one narration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam where he mentions that that person, how can he is haram, his drink is haram, his clothes that he is wearing is haram, and he is involved in haram. That is why they understood from that time, from the beginning, that halal income is very important. Halal sources are very important. If it so happens that we involve ourselves by mistake or by purpose, then we ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness. We return that money back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in charity, in sadaqah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His mercy will inshallah forgive us. That was a side point. But coming back, the reconstruction thereafter, when all the material was bought, when all the material was purchased, the reconstruction of the Kaaba was divided over the various clans of Quraysh. Everyone was assigned a specific portion of the reconstruction of the Kaaba and the process of building the Kaaba. The portions towards the door that we see today was assigned to Banu Abdul Manaf and Banu Zuhra. The area between Hajar al-Aswad, the black stone, and Rukna Yamani, the other stone that we see on the Kaaba, was allocated to Banu Makhzum and the other Qurayshi clans. The rear of the structure of the Kaaba was allocated to Banu Jahm and Banu Sahm. And the Hatim area section, where we see today the arch area around the Kaaba, many do not know, but this Hatim area, this Hatim area, this arch area was actually part of the Kaaba. But because they did not have enough resources at that time, enough income, enough money at that time to build the Kaaba, they were not able to build the entirety of the Kaaba. So the actual shape of the Kaaba is not a cube, is not a cube, but rather it is slightly rectangular. And the Hatim area, the arch area, is also part of the Kaaba. That is why it is known that whoever performs Salah in that area, in that arch area, it is like they have performed Salah inside the Kaaba, because it is part of the Kaaba. So this Hatim area, it was given to the Banu Abdul Dar bin Qusay and Banu Sa'ad people, and the process and the materials they were given to each clan for them to participate all in the building of the Kaaba. So it was not only on one person or a few people or the leaders of the Quraysh, but rather the entirety of the clan. This way, they all had a part in building and reconstructing the Kaaba, and all had the blessing and the reward of building the Kaaba together. The Quraysh, they got wind that a merchant ship had been wrecked when it entered the port of Jeddah. It was coming with goods, and on the way into the port of Jeddah, the ship had been wrecked. So Walid bin Mughira, he set off to go and retrieve the timber that was left from this shipwreck. With the council of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the people of Quraysh, of course, he went and he traveled to Jeddah, to the port of Jeddah, to retrieve the timber from this shipwreck. On this shipwreck, or on this ship, there was a Roman mason by the name of Baqum, who was also a master of carpentry, a master of reconstruction, a master of building things. So Walid bin Mughira, he also took this carpenter, this Roman mason, back with him, back to Makkah al-Mukarramah, to help with the reconstruction of the Kaaba. If anybody has seen the images of inside the Kaaba, they would notice that there are pillars inside the Kaaba, three pillars inside the Kaaba, and these are made of wood or the timber from the shipwreck. And thereafter, the lining of the Kaaba, the cube, is made out of concrete, cement. And this is how the Kaaba is standing, with a roof on top of it. Inshallah, in the next discussion, we will complete the reconstruction of the Kaaba and the story of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Hajar al-Aswad. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا رب.